Welcome to all of you friends. So how are you doing in the pink of your health? Hopefully good enough. So in this lecture, the today's topic for respiratory medicine part 8 is pneumothorax. Let's have a view at the lecture topics. Oh my god, it is not nursery school alphabetical study, right? It's something else. Thanks. Okay, let's start with it. Simple topic, small topic. Let's go. So what is pneumothorax? It is the presence of air between the visceral and parietal pleura. The presence of air between the visceral and parietal pleura. The hallmark is collapse of lung. What are the causes? Number one, it could be spontaneous. Number two, traumatic. Spontaneous, primary or secondary? Primary occurs like in a tall, thin person having history of smoking, and there is no clinical evidence of any lung disease. Whereas spontaneous secondary is having an underlying lung disease. So primary, usually like the patient presents, is usually a tall, thin smoker without any evidence or history of a lung disease. Whereas traumatic can be because of both blunt as well as sharp trauma. So blunt trauma, number one. Second, penetrating trauma. And number three, iatrogenic also. For example, thoracocentesis, central venous catheter and ventilator related barotrauma. Okay, so trauma can occur because of thoracocentesis when you are putting in such a large bore needle and trying to aspirate the fluid that might have collected because of pleural effusion, or a central venous catheterization is done, and ventilator associated barotrauma, right? The etiology means why it occurs, what are the causes of pneumothorax to develop, is very simple. A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H, I. So A, now without looking on the screen, you tell me using your common sense, what is A related to lung? Abscess. That means lung abscess. Good. B is bacterial pneumonia or necrotizing pneumonia. Okay. With C, we have five things. At least one or two you should guess. Yeah. If you guess COPD, correct. If you guess cystic fibrosis again, correct. Congenital cyst, correct. Any cavitary lesion, any cavity also is correct. And last, cancers, various different types of cancers, mesotheliomas, etc. They can also lead to the development of pneumothorax, right? Okay, with D, this is difficult, right? It's because indirect draining means thoracocentesis. E, come on, one at least. Guess one with E because there are three of them. Esophageal rupture. It's coming time and again, even in pleural effusion, 2-3 times this came, right? In left-sided pleural effusion and in the causes of pleural effusion also it was coming there in case of exudative type, right? So pleural this esophageal rupture is here also, it can cause pneumothorax. Another is endometriosis. You remember if you have seen my endometriosis lecture, I told you that the research has shown that endometriosis tissue, which is actually present in places like in the tubes or somewhere in the other parts of the, you know, tubes or ovaries, this endometriosis tissue is also sometimes present in the nose and lungs of the patient, right? And it can cause pneumothorax. So endometriosis. And E again is eosinophilic granuloma. So E could be esophageal rupture, endometriosis and eosinophilic granuloma. Okay. With F, F is fractured chest. Okay. G, again fracture, all this injury, gunshot injury, knife injury. Okay. With H, it would be HIV. In HIV, which pneumonia is very common? Pneumocystis gyrovesi. That is the newer name, and the older name was pneumocystis carinii. And I is iatrogenic again, like ventilator associated or central venous catheter associated or thoracocentesis associated, etc. So, will you tell me now A, B, C, D, E, F, J? Come on. A. With A, we have lung abscess of the lung. B, we have bacterial pneumonia, so necrotizing pneumonia. With C, we have COPDs, cystic fibrosis, congenital cyst, cavitary lesions, and cancers. Five things with C. Okay. With D we have draining, that is thoracocentesis. With E, we have number one esophageal rupture, number two endometriosis, and number three was eosinophilic granuloma. With F we have fracture of the chest. With G we have gunshot injuries or knife injuries, means all these injuries, you know, fractures, injuries, gunshot injuries, FGH. With H, we have HIV pneumocystis, giroese. And with I, we have iatrogenic. Thanks a lot for remembering the stuff, right? Okay. So you tell me now, what will be the clinical features? A patient is having pneumothorax. So what all will he come with the complaints of? Number one, it will be again a sudden onset breathlessness. Like when we were discussing about pulmonary embolism, there was a sudden onset breathlessness, dyspnea, that will be present over here also. On examination, there will be tachypnea and tachycardia. Okay, because there is a lot of anxiety related to it. The person cannot breathe. So the vitals shoot up. There is sympathetic activation in the body. So how tachypnea, tachycardia, diminished chest wall movements, because such a big pneumothorax, just like we studied in pleural effusion as well as pneumothorax, these will cause restrictive type of restriction in the lung because of restrictive causes in the pleura related. So they will not allow proper complete expansion of the lungs, and the chest wall movements therefore will be diminished. So chest wall movements are diminished, the person is tachypneic, dyspneic, and even having tachycardia or palpitations. Then the trachea is shifted to the same side or opposite side. Many people have this confusion that since the lung is collapsed in case of pneumothorax, the trachea will be shifted to the side of collapse. No, please. Just like it was in pleural effusion, the trachea will be deviated to the opposite side. Whether it is fluid, whether it is air, trachea is always deviated to the opposite side. So please don't have this misconceived notion. Okay, trachea is deviated to the opposite side even though the lung is collapsed, right? So if the pneumothorax is present on the left side, the trachea will be deviated towards the right side. Okay, here also trails sign will be positive like in pleural effusion. That means if pneumothorax is present on the left side, the trachea is deviated towards the right side. And on the right side, when you see the sternocleidomastoid muscle, example, the clavicular head of the SCM, it will be more prominent on the side opposite to the affected side. That means right side sternocleidomastoid muscle will be more prominent as compared to left side SCM. Now coming to TVF, when you will do this tectal vocal fremitis, it will be decreased or increased? It will be decreased. There also it was decreasing, here also it is decreasing, because the best media, all this increase when there is solid, when there is consolidation, because the best media for sound energy to travel is solid, followed by liquid, followed by gases. So this is gas, pneumothorax, air is filled, so TVF will decrease. The auscultatory component of TVF, that means vocal resonance, will also decrease. The breath sounds will be almost absent, because again breath sounds, they cannot be transmitted through gaseous matter, through gases, through air. So all that will be decreased. But when you try to percuss, you will get obviously a hyper resonant note, because so much air is filled up. So on percussion, there will be a hyper resonant note. Okay. And sometimes when you're trying to percuss the liver, because of this hyper resonant note, it can also hide the liver dullness in the fifth intercostal space, can also get obliterated if there is a right sided pneumothorax. Because when you have a right sided pneumothorax, it will give rise to a hyper resonant note, and this may obliterate and falsely hide the liver dullness in the fifth intercostal space, this hyper resonant note. So TVF, vocal resonance, all this will decrease on palpation, on auscultation, but when you percuss, on percussion, you will get a hyper resonant note because there is so much air filled there. Okay, and breath sounds are usually absent, but sometimes there is a condition of tension pneumothorax in which you get abnormal breath sounds, which are called amphoric breath sounds. These are actually type of bronchial breath sounds. You know, there are two types of breath sounds, vesicular and bronchial. Vesicular in a normal healthy patient are found all over the chest wall because of the normal lung parenchyma, and in a healthy patient the bronchial sounds are only seen over the trachea or the large airways like the main bronchi. So bronchial, the name is self-explanatory. But here in cases of certain conditions, I'm coming to that, we have a separate slide. So similarly, there are certain conditions in which even in the lung parenchyma or in the chest wall, you get to hear the bronchial breath sounds. So one of these conditions is related to this pneumothorax called tension pneumothorax, where you get amphoric breath sounds. These amphoric breath sounds have a characteristic metallic quality. Now, why? What is this tension pneumothorax? I will tell you very briefly. It's a simple thing. What happens, for example, here you can see in this diagram, for example, the visceral pleura has been ruptured because of some reason. So during inspiration, a lot of air will come with a gush and it will go and enter into the pleural space, in the pleural cavity. But what happens during expiration, this air, it pushes and almost seals that rupture close and does not escape, does not exit out. And that air keeps on collecting in the pleural cavity, and a lot of tension is is developed. That means the pressure of this air in the pleural cavity even is greater and exceeds the atmospheric pressure. And so the condition is called tension pneumothorax, because you are having a positive pressure or a higher pressure level in your lungs, not in the lungs, specifically in the pleural cavity, and which is even higher and exceeding the atmospheric pressure level. Okay, so this is tension pneumothorax. There is a rupture. The first, it starts with a rupture in the visceral pleura. When there is a rupture, there is a hole. For example, just think of a hole right now in a layman's way. So through this hole, during inspiration and during inhalation, all the gas, all the air will come in and it will go and enter into the pleural cavity. But during expiration, this air, when tries to escape, it actually seals or shuts that defect or that ruptured or that hole closed. Okay, this air which tries to exit with a high pressure, with a fast pace, it actually shuts the hole or this defect closed. It sort of seals it because of counter pressure and it cannot escape. So this air keeps on building, the pressure keeps on building, and it is called tension pneumothorax because the pressure is in the pressure value is exceeding the atmospheric pressure. Okay, and in this tension pneumothorax, when you try to auscultate it, there will be characteristic amphoric breath sounds, metallic quality breath sounds. Okay, so normal things I told you, vesicular versus bronchial. Now, bronchial breath sounds are of three types. Number one, tubular. Number two, cavernous. Number three is amphoric. Tubular ones are high-pitched, cavernous is low-pitched, and amphoric, as I told you, metallic quality. So where all will they be found? Tubular may be seen in case of pneumonias and consolidation. C for cavernous, C for cavity, and A for amphoric. But there is no alliteration. A, amphoric, it is seen in tension pneumothorax. Now, there is this pneumothorax is having one sign called Hammann's sign. Okay, Hammann's sign, it is what happens, a crunching sound which occurs with every heartbeat, whenever the heart beats. But your stethoscope is not over the heart, it is over the precordium. Because if your stethoscope is over the heart, then you will be only hearing the lub-dub, lub-dub, lub-dub sound, S1, S2, right? But your stetho is not over the heart. Your stetho is in the precordium. And with every heartbeat, you get to hear a crunching sound. Okay? And the reason for this is a spontaneous mediastinal emphysema. Spontaneous mediastinal emphysema. Okay, so what happens every time when the heart contracts, there is a direct contact, sort of a little rub, a little friction between the heart contracting and this air-filled tissue or the mediastinal emphysema. So therefore, with every heartbeat, this crunching sound is heard in the level of precordium, at the level of precordium, at the site of, at the rate of precordium. Okay, and now we're coming towards the end. Now there is a condition they can ask you, what do you mean by catamenial pneumothorax? Catamenial means anything related to the menstrual cycle. So here what happens, as I told you, there may be endometriosis which can be present even in the lungs. So there is a condition of pulmonary endometriosis, and so pneumothorax develops with every menstrual cycle. So what is the emergency treatment of pneumothorax? A person comes to you in severe distress, sudden onset, breathlessness, tachypneic, having palpitations, very much in apprehension, anxiety and all. So we'll quickly do a large bore needle puncture. That is the emergency treatment. You won't go for a chest x-ray because you know the signs, you know the important presentation. And if your diagnosis and if your gut feeling is going towards a pneumothorax and the patient is in an emergency state, in an unstable state, the vitals are not proper, so you just have to go directly for a large bore needle puncture. In the question, they will give you options. So don't get deluded by chest x-ray. No, we'll directly go for a large bore needle puncture. Okay. So clinical features in the x-ray, the mainstay is x-ray. X-ray is very good. It tells all the important signs and we can make a very easy, cool diagnosis with the help of chest x-ray itself. Number one, there will be increased radiolucency, which we call in a layman's term, it will appear more black. That means those bronchovascular markings won't be seen. Bronchovascular markings are a little whitish, opaque, right? So there will be all blackness. That is actually said increased radiolucency means air, because of the presence of air. Because of presence of air, and so no bronchovascular markings. Number two, there will be collapse of lungs. Okay. And in this, we'll see when there is a collapse of lungs, there will be the visceral pleura will be represented by a white line, by distinct white line. I'll show you that in the radiograph. And last, again, shift to the trachea to the opposite side. Now, what is the treatment? It depends on the size. Number one, if it is small. Number two, if it is large. Number three, if it's recurrent, occurring time and again. And number four, if it's even more recurrent and problematic and ICD has failed. Okay. In case of small spontaneous, obviously the patient will be almost asymptomatic or having very mild dyspnea. So we do nothing. We just wait and watch. And we usually, because there is usually a spontaneous resolution, so we usually don't want to intervene. But if it's a large pneumothorax, the patient is also having some symptoms, having dyspnea. So you have two options. Number one, you can go again, as I told you, that large bore needle puncture. If that does not work, patient is still, the symptoms are not getting relieved, then you can go for an ICD, intercostal drainage, or the chest tube placement. Intercostal drainage ICD may be placed in case of second condition, a large pneumothorax which is symptomatic, and you tried the needle puncture but that is not working, the symptoms are not getting relieved, just go for an ICD, chest tube placement. The third condition is, you treat once, the patient is fine. Again, after 2-3 months, he comes again and again. The episodes are repeating. It's recurrent in nature. So here you'll have to go for pleurodesis. Here we'll go for pleurodesis. That means we try to obliterate with the pleural cavity by inducing a scar tissue formation, so that the vitreal and parietal pleura, they just sort of stick to each other, and that potential pleural cavity is actually closed. It's no more a potential cavity. We try to ensure that the visceral and pleural visceral and parietal pleura, they get opposed to each other, a scar tissue formation is induced. Okay, the pleural cavity is completely obliterated. And the last is more problematic, recurrent, severe, even ICD has failed, all that. So here we'll go for a pleurectomy. Let's have a look at the awesome images. So ABCD, you know this. Now these are the various types of breath sounds, right? So in case of these are all types of bronchial breath sounds. Number one, tubular. 2, cavernous, and 3, is amphoric. Tubular is a high-pitched sound. It's seen in consolidation like pneumonia. Second is cavernous, low-pitched sound. So C for cavernous and C for cavity. And last is amphoric sounds, which are having a metallic quality, seen in tension pneumothorax. So this is what I was talking about. Pneumothorax can be closed, open, and tension. Like we have classified in the basis of spontaneous and traumatic, spontaneous, primary, and secondary. You can also classify it on the basis of closed, open, and tension pneumothorax. In closed, what is happening? The pleural cavity pressure is less than the atmospheric pressure. In open, there is a direct continuity between the two. So the pressure in the pleural cavity will be equal to the atmospheric pressure, whereas in tension pneumothorax, it is more than the atmospheric pressure. So this is x-ray, very important. There are high chances that this x-ray can come in any of your exams, because it is simple and it is expected of us to diagnose pneumothorax with the help of this x-ray. Okay, so what are the three findings? All of them are seen here. Come on, tell me quickly, fast. What is there? Increased radiolucency. So always you have to compare on two sides. Look on the right hand side, here you are having all the distinct bronchovascular markings, that whiteness, that opacity is there. Whereas here on the left side, you are seeing it is more black. Okay, because of air. And how will you say that? You will say that on the left side, I can see increased radiolucency. Number two, I told you the visceral pleura will be represented by a white line. So here you cannot see, visceral pleura is here only. This is the visceral pleura and this is the parietal pleura, and they are almost opposed to each other. Because in the x-ray, the pleural cavity is only a very, very small potential space, only 8 to 10 ml fluid is there. But here, if this is the parietal pleura, which is always, you know, in relation to the chest wall, this here is the visceral pleura. So visceral pleura, can you see how much massive shifting of the visceral pleura? Okay, so visceral pleura is represented by the white line. And the third sign was the trachea deviating to the opposite side, the deviation of trachea to the opposite side. So very three simple signs, and everyone can tell that. Okay, number one was that increased radiolucency, number two was the white line of the pleura, that means lung collapse, and number three was deviation of the trachea to the opposite side. Thank you. Good. So radiograph was simple, easy, and fun. Okay. So this is the chest tube placement. You can do it in the second or third intercostal space, along the midclavicular line, or along the anterior axillary line. This is pleurodesis, where we try to, you know, create or induce a scar tissue formation, so that we are actually sealing that potential pleural cavity. And this is the surgery, pleurectomy, when we have a problematic recurrent pneumothorax, which is also not responding with the tube or the drain or the ICD placement. So that was all for this lecture. Thanks a lot for watching, and please do like, subscribe, share, and comment. Have a good day.